Good morning. God's grace and peace be with you. I'm David Chisholm, pastor here, First Christian Church. If you've been worshiping with us for a lifetime, or this is your first time, we are glad that you are with us this morning. One sign that we feel like hopefully COVID is finally passing by, you will find at the inside of the pew, attendance books. We ask that you would please take out that black attendance book, fill out your name, your family name. If you are new with us, you haven't given us contact information before, or if something has maybe changed recently and we need to get some updated information, at the bottom of that page, there's a space for you to fill out your contact information. Please pass those down, and as they come back, you can always see who else is worshiping on the same pew with you this morning. Thanksgiving lunch is today. Everybody excited about that? My Sunday school was over in the fellowship hall, and it smells like turkey over there. I mean, it smells good. Everything is provided for you, so invite you, even if you didn't plan to stay for lunch, please, after service this morning, please go over with us and join us for Thanksgiving lunch together. Also, following that lunch back here in the sanctuary, we'll be giving our first post-Thanksgiving meal workout session. We are going to do some decorating in here, and Martha wants to make sure that you know you are invited to come and help her. She's only had a couple people touch base with her so far, so if you could come back after lunch and burn a few calories off as we prepare for Advent, we would really appreciate the extra help. Also, hopefully you saw it when you walk in, we have our chalice tree, our angel tree, at work at the back in the entryway here. Margie House and Julie Flores are back there to help you out. If you would like to adopt a child, a family, and help purchase a nice Christmas for them, they can help you out with all the information that you will need. No children or youth activities tonight. We'll resume those in a couple of weeks here, taking a break for the holiday. Question of the day, in this week of Thanksgiving, what are you thankful for? Very simple question. What has been important for you this year, something that God has provided that you are especially thankful for? Just before our call to worship, we do have one other Thanksgiving-themed video to share with you. When I first got here, I was talking to Peggy, and Peggy said, you know, we really could use a little extra help in the food pantry on Wednesdays, and I was going to try to, you know, twist some arms around here. And out of the blue, out of nowhere, a life skills class from Midland High School started coming over and helping us out each Wednesday. So we have a little video to share with you and some of the ways we have folks out of the community helping us reach out and help the community. Please cue up that video now.
We come over here to do the food pantry with First Christian Church. My students, they're very inviting and giving. They've accepted us to help with the food pantry and to give the food to all the people that come here. My students have learned so much about giving to the community, and that we don't just, you know, we can take when we are in need, but that how many people are actually in need here in the community. And it's been a big blessing for all of us, and it makes me so happy. And I think in turn, the kids see how happy it makes me, and it makes them happy to serve the ones here that need the food.
Well, my name is Brittany Jackson, and I work for Midland Independent School District at Midland High Life Skills. And I think doing the pantry is important for us because it shows our children how to be appreciative and helpful to others. And I think that's just a good learning experience for our kids to know that it's okay to help other people. And if you see somebody in need, you know, it's a good thing to help. And just don't look past them or, you know, treat them any different. And I just think that with their disabilities, it's teach them as well that they can go on and do things like that if they want to in their near future.
Together, let us lift up our hearts to the Lord. Consider the lilies of the field. They neither sow nor spin. The birds of the sky do not plant nor farm. Let us seek first God's kingdom, believing that God will provide. Let us pray as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Come, you. campus.
And we just wanted to say a big thank you to all of you for your continued support of our ministry and academic endeavors here at TCU. We truly, truly appreciate it.
Here are a few students who are going to give a few words about what TCU and your contributions mean to them. Hello, my name is Jonah, and for the last 3 years I've been to DOC, and it's definitely equipped everyone I know to make the world a better place and be awesome people. DOC has been my second family at TCU, and every week I look forward to each one of our events, and it is such a fun time to be there and have fun with everyone around me.
Hi, my name is Gabriella. I'm a senior at TCU, and my favorite thing about my college experience so far has been getting to meet and form deep relationships with other Disciple students. I also love that our campus ministry, Disciples on Campus, is so connected to other ministers and churches in the Texas region.
Hello, my name is William Farrow, and I'm a junior here at Texas Christian University. And along with making many friends through Disciple on Campus, I've also been able to make relationships with my professors on campus, furthering my education so thankful that I was able to choose university where that was a possibility.
Hi, my name is Anna, and I chose TCU because when I was in high school, I really loved going to camp events. I was on leadership team, and I just made so many great connections through Disciples Ministries. And when I toured TCU, it just felt like the perfect place to make those new connections with Disciples Ministries. And overall, it's just been an amazing experience, and I've met so many awesome people through Disciples on Campus.
Hi, my name is Dylan Wiley, and I chose TCU because it was a place that I could go to that already had a strong Disciples core at it, and a lot of friends that I knew going into it from various regional ministries that I was a part of, as well as it was an opportunity for me to major in religious studies around many fellow disciples and explore potentially pursuing ministry.
I chose to come to TCU because I knew there would be a disciples religious connection here that I wouldn't be able to find anywhere else, and that would be super important to me as I discerned my call to ministry and decided to study religion in my college experience. And as I've been here, it's just been such an amazing opportunity to get to know so many disciples and become so much more devoted to my faith because I have people from the same denomination surrounding me, not only in Disciples on Campus, but also in my religion classes that help me and motivate me to be the best version of myself.
Out in the narthex. All right. Do you know what 4 days from today is? Thanksgiving. It's a time every year when we kind of set aside a time to be thankful. And we gather with our family and our friends, and we think about all the things we're thankful for on that particular day. But you know, we should always have an attitude of thanksgiving. And on Thanksgiving, when you get with your family, there's all this delicious food that you eat, and I love it all. I'm not like some of you. I'm not picky. I like the dressing and the gravy and the mashed potatoes and the turkey and the cranberry sauce and the mac and cheese and the green beans. And I just eat and I eat and I eat, so I'm so full. But you know what? Thanksgiving dinner is not complete unless you have some yummy dessert. And my favorite for Thanksgiving is pumpkin pie. And this is really, really yummy to my tummy, especially this morning. I haven't had anything to eat. But I started to put whipped cream on it, but I thought by the time it came to this time, it'd be kind of gross. And I'll be melted. So I want you to know, though, that we're not supposed to be just thankful on Thanksgiving. Because I could sit here and I could eat the rest of this pie, and it's so yummy and it's so good and it's just right. But when I finish eating it, it's gone. There's no more pie. But when we're thankful every single day and we thank God for all that God does for us, will God be like this pie and simply disappear? No. He's with us all of the time, everywhere, no matter how we're feeling, whether we're happy or sad, or sometimes even mad, or maybe our tummies might even be a little full from eating. God's always with us. And you know, knowing that God is with us and we give thanks to God every day is the sweetest thing ever. In fact, it's even sweeter than this pumpkin pie, because the pumpkin pie won't be with me always. So can you remember that? Well, you could, but you can't, you know, God's always with you. You don't have to go up the store to buy him, do you? Okay, let's say a prayer. And you can go to Children's Church, and you can ask them those questions, okay? Okay. Well, let's say a prayer. Our gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for all. We thank you for a piece of pumpkin pie, but may these children understand that no matter how good that tastes, that it doesn't last forever. It quickly disappears. Whereas you will never, ever, ever disappear from our lives. And having you in our lives is the sweetest, best thing ever. And we give you thanks for you. Help these children to understand and to know that. It's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.
As we pray today, I would ask that we would take a moment of silence and remember the community of Andrews and Andrews High School. As you may have heard, their instrumental music program was traveling to a playoff football game Friday night and was involved in an accident where their band director, the bus driver, and then the individual driving entering the highway in front of them also passed away. So please remember the Anders community in prayer. And also, as we pray today, this is Thanksgiving Sunday. In 1621, when the pilgrims gathered to pray, undoubtedly they prayed spontaneously. While we do not know their words specifically, a typical Thanksgiving prayer was offered, and I will share that by George Webb, written in 1625, of a typical Thanksgiving prayer on that first time of Thanksgiving. Let us observe a moment of silence. O Lord, our God and Heavenly Father, which of thy unspeakable mercy toward us has provided meat and drink for the nourishment of our weak bodies, grant us peace to use them reverently as from thy hands with thankful hearts. Let thy blessing rest upon these, thy good sir creatures, to our comfort and sustenance, and grant that we humbly beseech thee, good Lord, that as we do hunger and thirst for this food of our bodies, so may our souls earnestly long after the food of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 25 through 33. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
There was a pivotal moment this past spring as I and my family were considering a call to come and serve a church in West Texas. We made a visit to Abilene for a family wedding. The interview process with Midland hadn't opened up at that point, but it had been quite a while since I had been in West Texas. In my memory, all that I thought of when I thought of West Texas is that it's hot, it's dry, it's dusty, and the wind always blows. Which isn't too far from the truth now, is it? But when we arrived in Abilene, it was March, I discovered that y'all were having just a beautiful spring out here. The rains had been coming in, the temperatures were nice. And what we found as we drove from Louisiana through into Texas, God was putting on a big old show. It was bluebonnet season. And I don't know if you remember this past spring, but the bluebonnets were insane. Now, I have to ask, do bluebonnets make it all the way out to Midland? Not so much. Okay, all right. Well, maybe you've heard of them. But it wasn't just the bluebonnets either. The sunflowers, Indian blankets, the Drummond phlox, the verbena, scads of wildflowers. I don't know, maybe the highway department had thrown the seed out, but had left him alone. And it was just between the soil and God what happened next. And what happened was just breathtaking. Even all of those construction delays on I-20 were tolerable when you could look around and the culverts and the sides and the countryside, they were just covered in beautiful, beautiful colors. This morning we come to this gospel reading as our nation pauses for a Thanksgiving celebration. Certainly one of the few sacred days in our year as a nation. And though the wildflowers of spring may be long gone for us, the memory of those bluebonnets are on my mind as we hear these words from Jesus. Now, Jesus didn't have bluebonnets, but he had what he called lilies. If you dig into the Greek behind that, the word is takrina. That's the word in Greek for lilies. But that word lilies actually could mean any of a number of wildflowers that grew abundantly on the hillsides of Galilee. Jesus tells us if God can clothe weeds with such glory, glory that even King Solomon, with all of his wealth, all of his fabulous fabulous wisdom could acquire for himself, if God could clothe weeds greater than even King Solomon, weeds that would one day be mulched by a lawnmower, how much more will God provide for you? How much more valuable are you than these weeds on the hillsides? What good is worrying about your clothing and what you look like or what you're going to eat or obsessing about where you're going to live? What is that going to do for you? I suppose you could make a pretty good argument that worry actually does work. I'll be honest with you, there have been some times in my life, and this past year was no different, that there were some things that I kind of obsessed about, things I worried about, disasters that I saw coming my way, and after sleepless nights and days with that sick feeling in my stomach, the expected apocalypse didn't come, which kind of proves right there. Most of the things you worry about don't end up happening anyway. So I guess worry works, right? Is that what we learn from that? No, the thing is, as much as we do worry, we end up forgetting that it's actually God that we need to trust. Worry just tears us apart inside, shortens our lives. Heard about a man who was driving around downtown Houston. He was in a complete panic because he had to give a presentation and his company was counting on him. And he couldn't find a parking spot anywhere. Driving circles in this panic, he began to look for some supernatural intervention. He began praying to God, looking up to the sky, "Please take pity on me. Help me find a parking place. If you do, I'll be a faithful church member. I'll tithe. I'll pray every day for the rest of my life." And miraculously, at the last second, right in front of the front doors, a car pulled out. He slipped in. He looked up to heaven. And he said, "Never mind, I found one anyway." Seriously, Jesus sets before us a choice that we make either consciously or unconsciously. What will we rely on for security in our lives? We need clothing, we need food, we need housing. This Thanksgiving, is that what we're thinking about, is just making sure that we have those things? Or do we turn in trust to God that God provides our security? God knows what we need. God has our interests in mind. It's not to say that we shouldn't keep savings or plant crops to harvest. But if that is our only priority in life, if that is our greatest passion, we miss out enjoying that God simply provides things, the blue bonnets in the fields that make spring so beautiful for us. I grew up in Kansas, but I was a kid of the suburbs. I didn't live out where the farm kids lived. When I needed food, I just went to the grocery store. If I needed clothing, I went down to the mall, and if I could afford it, I'd buy the nice clothes that were in style. The weather didn't give it a second thought most of the time. The first church that I served as a weekend minister when I was in Bible college, Peeled Oak Christian Church. It's a picturesque little place. It was a little white clapboard, single building. Sat way out in Appalachia, Bath County, Kentucky. And literally, it was surrounded by a cemetery on the front and a tobacco field in the back. Like 4 feet off the back wall, tobacco stood out there in season, taller than me. The leaves were bigger than my shirts. Huge plants. It was a hard scrabble existence for the folks who attended that church. And I could tell me, fresh out of high school, suburban kid, I wasn't connecting well with them. I sat down and asked one of my church members if he could help me understand what faith meant for them. I could tell I was talking at a a way that it just wasn't connecting with them. This man, he had actually gone off. He had gotten a steady job. He was working for a Toyota plant near Lexington, Kentucky. But he grew up out there, and his life was still connected to living in that rural place. He said, you know, living out here, you learn to simply trust. Your life is connected to things like rain and sun and what the temperature is outside. You need water at the right time. The crops have to be planted at the right time. And when it comes to water, these are Appalachian folks. They don't have a lot of money. They can't buy expensive irrigation systems. They rely on the rain. And tobacco, there's no machines to take care of it. If you need help in your field, you call your neighbors and they'll be there for you. And if your neighbor needs help, then you go help them as well. There weren't many details in life that you could control. Most things were literally in God's hand. And he said, the amazing thing is that despite setbacks and droughts and floods and market fluctuations and legal entanglements about tobacco crops and a million other things that could go wrong, he said, the folks who have faith, the folks who have learned to simply trust God, they make a way. They get through. They find a way to keep their families together, to keep living to see another day. He said, if you come with just a simple message like that, we'll hear what you're talking about. Jesus reminds us this morning, seek first God's kingdom. Seek God's righteousness. Just trust God and these other things, the food, the shelter, the clothing you need. God knows what you need. God will take care of those things. This Thanksgiving is a special one for me. I haven't taken up farming, but this last year, the last year and a half, I'd say, it's been a million things that have kind of gone sideways. There's been a million things that I've worried and obsessed about. And you know what? I've found along the way with life experience, just like those farmers in eastern Kentucky, it's just taken faith to get us through. Think about our move here. I was worried about a job for my wife, Corey. When we moved to Baton Rouge, it was 6, 7, or 8 months for us to find a job there. Midland is a smaller place. My fear was, we're going to move here. It might be a year and a half before my wife finds a job. Or maybe she gets here and someone sees a resume and designs a job right around her. All my worry and obsession about that, I just would have trusted God. Faith would have helped me see myself to the other side. Perhaps your year has been blessed, as my year has been blessed. Perhaps it's been a challenging year. I don't know if you've kept up with the story of Mike and Kathy Landrum, but since I've arrived here, I've been listening very closely to what's happening in their lives. If you're not familiar, Kathy has had some serious health issues with the circulation, aneurysms and blockages, and the blood flow to her brain. A couple of months ago, she had a very serious surgery. They actually rerouted how the blood flows through her brain. I, when they were telling me about these surgeries, I was like, is this out of science fiction or what? I never heard of these kinds of things being done before, miraculous things that science has figured out. But that first surgery was a preparation for a second 9-hour-long surgery in which they went in, cleared up the blockages, rerouted things. Incredible stuff that they did. Coming out of that, Science being what it is, still, this was a serious surgery, and Kathy is going through a lot of rehab right now. She's having to relearn how to talk. She's having to relearn just basic functions of life, and it's hard. It's hard. Mike has been a faithful companion to her through all of this. He's been great to send out just short emails to some folks in the church. The one he sent to us yesterday touched me deeply. I want to share that with you with his permission this morning. He said, "It's been quite a day at rehab. Kathy mostly slept all day. She says she's tired. It is the first chance she has had to really rest. Said, I mostly read articles on my iPad." He says this to us, "Thank you for all your prayers and statements of support coming our way. We know the road can be long, but we are thankful for the road. God is by our side. God is by our side. Mike and Kathy. Even in the most difficult situations in life, if we simply trust and listen, know that God is there, God will provide, we will find God is by our side. One of my preaching traditions on the Sunday before Thanksgiving is to ask my congregation what they're thankful for, so I continue that tradition this morning. I want to ask you, what is it that you have experienced in your faith life this last year? What are you thankful for as you prepare for this Thanksgiving celebration? Please name those aloud at this time.
Family.
Family. What else?
Friends.
What has God provided for you this year? I'm sorry? You got to say it real loud.
Christ.
Health.
Peggy Jones.
What else?
Courage.
Salvation.
Miracles. Faith.
Love.
So many things, simple things. It's a simple message that Christ gives us this morning. In this season of Thanksgiving, let us be thankful for all that the Lord has provided for us. Let's join together in prayer. Lord, as we look to the world around us, see those simple signs of beauty, the highways and byways of life, the simple ways that you provide for us, that enrichen who we are, that lead us to trust you more. Help us continue to deepen that trust in you. Let the things of this world that distract and detract from us, let us set those aside. Lord, you know what we need. We humbly and simply and with thanksgiving ask that daily bread would be provided. Help us to trust you more each day. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we prepare to gather around Christ's table, let us sing together in remembrance of me.
In remembrance of me. Remembrance of me, drink this wine. In remembrance of me, grateful.
could go on and on and on. But every single day, every single day of our life, the one thing that we have that we can always be thankful for and that we need to give thanks to is that we have a loving and caring, merciful, forgiving Savior in our lives, Jesus Christ. The greatest gift that you and I have ever received or will have ever received is the gift that God gave us through His Son, Jesus. And today, as we gather around this table and we eat of the bread and we drink of the cup, may we give thanks for that great gift. Together now, let us affirm our faith. We confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and proclaim Him Lord and Savior of the world. Let us pray.
God, we thank You for Your presence, for Your loving grace, for the gift of Your Spirit. You have shaped us as Your people, and You nourish us with this bread of life, this cup of salvation. May the blessings of this table strengthen our faith as we are one in You. We pray in the name of the risen Jesus. Amen.
On that night when Jesus gathered around the table with His disciples, He took the bread, He blessed it, and He broke it, and He said to them, "Take, eat, and do so in remembrance of Me." Let us partake of our bread together. In the same manner, after supper, Jesus took the cup. He raised it and He gave thanks and He said to them, "This cup is a new covenant of My blood shed for many for the forgiveness of sin. Take, drink, and do so in remembrance of Me." Let us drink the cup together. For as often as you eat of this bread and you drink of this cup, you proclaim our Lord's death until He comes again. Now let us take just a few moments for reflection.
Thank you.
This time we offer an invitation to that one or those who would like to be joined with our Lord through confession of faith and baptism. That one of those who would like to place their membership, that one of those who would like to recommit himself or herself to the Lord. Please come forward as we lift up our hearts singing together, "Blessed be the tie that binds." Have a few announcements before we close here. Remember Thanksgiving lunch over in the Family Life Center. We have a couple things going on over there. You will find a large Scrabble board as you are waiting to enter. On that Scrabble board, our youth and our children have already laid out some words for Thanksgiving. We want to invite you to add your words of Thanksgiving as well. Also on your tables, you will find this form. We're going to try something a little new here. Remember, a couple weeks, I talked about a baptismal service in which folks shared some things, some ways that they can help each other. If you have some, it doesn't have to be a talent, just you're willing to do something like lawn mowing, grocery shopping, preparing a meal, if somebody finds themselves in need of a ride somewhere, if there's some way that you might be able to help out a fellow member of the congregation, invite you to write it on this form and at each of the exits in the Family Life Center. Leave that there. Make sure you put your name on it so we know who you are. And if we get a call from somebody and they might need just some simple act of service, we'll know who we might be able to call on for that. Also, following the meal, after we clean up, please come back, help us to decorate for Advent. Remember, next Sunday is the beginning of Advent, our preparation for Christmas, a great time to invite a friend. Like and share us on Facebook. Help us get the word out of some of the great things that God is doing through this community of First Christian Church. We're going to, first of all, join together with a blessing for our food, and then we will sing our choral benediction. Let us join together in prayer. Lord, with humble hearts we pray your blessing upon your people as we join in this Thanksgiving feast. We ask that at our tables, where we feel your grace and providence, that you will remind us of the bounty we've harvested in farm and field, at home, in our places of work, and most importantly, as servants of your kingdom. We thank you for those who have labored to prepare this meal that we share. We thank you for those who will labor to clean up after us. Thank you for the bonds of family and kinship. And as our work and sharing strengthens our love and fellowship, we pray that your love will bless each table, each home. We pray especially for those who struggle to put food on their table and find shelter in their lives. May your peace and providence visit all people this Thanksgiving. Amen. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say it, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone, because the Lord is near you. Do not worry about anything. In everything, with prayer and appeal and thanksgiving, let God know what you need. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.